Good morning, everyone. Oh, a bit loud there. And good evening to those watching this later online. Today we have been given an opportunity. And it is an opportunity because, as Richard said, originally we were going to have some visitors this morning, but it was not meant to be. And instead, we have an opportunity to continue to think about the work of the Holy Spirit, and more specifically, the receiving of supernatural visions as we look at the reading from the book of Revelation. Now, fairly recently as church, we have looked at the spiritual gifts that are given to enhance community life amongst God's people. And we've heard that these gifts are numerous and meet different needs as they build up the body of Christ and are used in mission. We also have heard how their use is not only motivated through love, but is rooted in the spiritual kingdom of God and therefore the supernatural realm of the Holy Spirit. To recap further, some gifts reflect the doing of community life as they offer practical help and service, whilst others reflect the being of community life as they discern and reveal in unique ways the heart, reality, and power of God. All the gifts have equal importance, and whilst it's tempting to focus on the ones that we can understand, do or express physically, it is necessary for us to widen our horizons to the prophetic and to those gifts which minister specifically into the spiritual dimension of people's lives. And this necessity involves us going deeper in our understanding and experience of the supernatural presence of God. I wonder if you remember what I said a few weeks ago, that there is so much more potential for all of us to realise as we seek to know the Lord Jesus more clearly, as we seek to love him more deeply, and as we seek to follow him more nearly. And tapping into this potential is for both our spiritual growth and the mission of Christ's church. But before I share what's been put on my heart concerning our reading from Revelation and the work of the Holy Spirit, I want to clarify the meaning of the word supernatural. It simply means beyond the powers of laws and nature, the miraculous. And in our gospel reading, we had, didn't we, the supernatural event of Jesus calming the storm. The Christian faith is a supernatural faith. It goes beyond and cannot be bound by the powers of laws and nature, and it goes beyond and cannot be bound by our own understanding or reasoning. There is a quote by a Christian author which may be of some help to us here. The faith of the Bible is about a supernatural person, God, who speaks in a supernatural revelation, the Bible, of the supernatural coming, the virgin birth, of the supernatural Saviour, Jesus Christ, who in a supreme supernatural event, the resurrection, demonstrates that he has wrought, achieved supernatural salvation at the cross, which is focused in a supernatural experience common to every Christian, the new birth. Wow. The supernaturality, yes, that is a word, the supernaturality of our faith cannot be denied, even though some do attempt to deny it. I once heard an ordained minister express their belief that the virgin birth could have happened, or equally, it could be just a metaphor. Let me tell you, the virgin birth most certainly happened. The supernatural coming of the supernatural Saviour was a reality is a reality, and belief that says otherwise or welcomes compromise is building a basis of faith not on solid rock, but on sand which cannot stand. Looking again at that quote, if I was to add a sentence onto the end, I would say the following words, starting with "and." And in turn is expressed by the born-again Christian through the supernatural empowering of the Holy Spirit. Now, this doesn't really make sense on its own. So let's hear my addition with the rest of those sentences. And I'll take a deep breath. The faith of the Bible is about a supernatural person, God, who speaks in a supernatural revelation, the Bible, of the supernatural coming, the virgin birth, of the supernatural Saviour, Jesus Christ, who in a supreme supernatural event, the resurrection, demonstrates that he has achieved supernatural salvation at the cross, which is focused in a supernatural experience common to every Christian, the new birth, and in turn is expressed by the born-again Christian through the supernatural empowering of the Holy Spirit. Phew. The Christian faith is a supernatural faith, and it is not uncommon to hear the phrase naturally supernatural to describe the born-again Christian life. I like that quote. And I like it because it reminds us also of the importance of the cross. It reminds us that without the cross, without that which Christ did for us on the cross, there would have been no Pentecost or the intimate gift of the Holy Spirit for those who confess that Jesus is Lord. Let's never lose the wonder of the cross, even when we think about spiritual gifts and about the supernatural empowering of the Holy Spirit. So turning to our reading in Revelation, we have a vision that was given to the author John. Now, it is interesting to note that visions and indeed dreams are not included among the lists of the gifts of the Holy Spirit. But these lists are not meant to be exhaustive. Visions and dreams are an important aspect of the work of the Holy Spirit, and they can be channels through which words of wisdom or knowledge or prophecy come. And this is most certainly the case in Revelation. The visions are given to John, and they are key elements of a prophetic message to encourage and warn Christ's church, including us. And the beginning of Revelation tells us that what was recorded was given by God. So in chapter 4, John describes the vision he received of heaven, the amazing heavenly throne room. This chapter's central message is that the covenant creator God rules and reigns. Now, there are so many key elements to this vision, and we could learn many things about the character of God. And I would really encourage you to look into this passage yourselves with a study Bible or other study notes to find out more and to find out how chapter 4 fits in within the wider perspective of the whole book of Revelation. And the focus that I want to have today is not the vision per se, but is about how John received the vision. Now, although no one can make God give them visions, we can learn how to be open and receptive channels to this element of the Spirit's work. Our text says that John was in the Spirit, and this is the second time that phrase appears in Revelation. In chapter 1, John says, on the Lord's day, I was in the Spirit. And here he is in chapter 4, again in the Spirit. Something supernatural is going on. And John is experiencing the miraculous operation of the Spirit of God. And he is seeing more deeply into the mysteries of the kingdom of God. But let's note the context. It was the Lord's day. And there is no reason to think that it was not still the Lord's day by the time of this heavenly throne room experience. Now, the Lord's day does refer to the first day of the week, but it also refers to time set apart for the Lord. And this time saw John remembering the resurrection of Christ through prayer and worship. He was, in a sense, having his own service. And by this time, he had been exiled to an island called Patmos because he preached the word of God and the testimony of Jesus Christ. So what can we learn? We can learn that to be open and receptive channels to the supernatural work of the Holy Spirit, we need to be a prayerful and a worshipful people. John made himself available to receive this vision, which was not only encouragement for himself and the persecuted church at the time, but also significant for every Christian since. There is a fresh call to us this morning to be available to God through prayer and worship and resting in his presence, particularly as we seek to understand, experience more of his supernatural reality. This availability may see us receive visions, or it may be a foundation from which we experience the supernatural work of the Spirit at other times. And our availability is not limited to receiving of visions, but to those other gifts which speak into the spiritual dimension of people's lives. When I spoke a few weeks ago, I shared a little bit of the Spirit's work in my life. And to share a little more, I have found that prayer and worship are a foundation for me experiencing not visions, because these usually come when someone is awake, but God-given dreams. The content of these dreams has sometimes been used in sermons, not that anyone would know, or is revealing something for me to ponder on concerning the work of God. And when I look back on my life, I can identify that this learning to be available started when I worked in the NHS and when I dedicated time to the Lord to pray and seek his will before I had a particular job interview. And this setting of time apart started to teach me how God can communicate with his people in supernatural ways. The call to be available to God is for times both on our own and with God's people. And it's really encouraging that John reminds us that even when we're on our own, God will meet with us and he will bless us. And so I wonder, what would help us to be available to God? Or perhaps to be available more often? And I ask that question to myself as well. I have this deep, deep sense of conviction that the community life of God's people in any place and in any setting needs to ensure that being available to God through prayer and worship takes its central place, and not only if there is time amongst the doing or the busyness. Prayer and worship is, in a sense, work, and we may be challenged to consider what our priority for this looks like outside the regularity of Sunday worship. There is a verse from James's letter in the Bible which is also appropriate here. It says, the prayer of a righteous person is powerful and effective. And this also informs us that to be open and receptive channels to the supernatural work of the Spirit, we need to be in that right standing with God. Now, what Jesus did for us on the cross puts us in that right standing. But it may be that we need to examine and put right certain things before the cross of Christ, such as our attitudes, relationships, unforgiveness, or other things which clash with being a follower of Jesus. The Apostle John said yes to Jesus. He received the gift of the Holy Spirit. He was open to the work of the Holy Spirit. We may have already said yes to Jesus, but have we actually received the Holy Spirit into our hearts? Have we the desire to be open and receptive channels through which the supernatural work of the Holy Spirit can operate? Now, in the 14th century, Julianne of Norwich, at the age of 30, experienced great suffering in illness. And in the midst of prayer, she received a vision of Christ on the cross. Let's listen to her words. As I looked, I saw the body bleeding heavily, apparently from the flogging. The smooth skin was gashed, and all over his body I saw deep wheals in the tender flesh caused by many sharp blows. The blood flowed so hot and thick that neither the wounds nor the skin could be seen. It was all covered in blood. The blood flowed all down his body, but at the point of falling to the ground, it disappeared. The bleeding continued for a while, giving me time to see it and think about it. It was so heavy that I thought that if it had been real, the whole bed and everything around would have been soaked in blood. The beloved blood of our Lord Jesus Christ is truly as plentiful as it is precious. Look and see for yourself. It flows over the whole world, ready to wash every human being from all sin, present, past, and future, if they are willing. This is another example of what could happen if someone desires to be an open and receptive channel through which the supernatural work of the Holy Spirit can operate. What an encouragement this would have been for her in a time of suffering. And it has been a blessing for others since. And a particular saying originates from this vision and has ministered to many people throughout the years, even now. And this saying may specifically speak to you this morning. With God, all shall be well, and all shall be well, and all manner of thing shall be well. If that does speak to you today, know that the hands of God hold you and carry you. So let's respond to that fresh call this morning of being available to God. Let's desire to go deeper in our experience of God's supernatural presence. And let's always have the cross of Christ in view. And I want to finish with a verse that's been on my mind as I've prepared this, but I'm going to use its words in a form of a blessing. So may we seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. And as we do so, may all other things, including spiritual gifts, be given to us as well. Amen.